We are praying and the church say loud, amen. Please take your seat. The Lord bless you. I want to welcome you to church this morning. It's our relationship service. We are glad to have you here. One of the things that makes us unique as a church is that we preach the whole counsel of God. You know, if you are the Triumphant Academy this morning, we were speaking about holiness. And then we have a particular week in every month that we speak about relationship and marriage, because that's a critical part of your life. Every man, every woman, marriage and relationship is a critical part of every man and every woman's life. God created us to be relational. As a matter of fact, the first institution that we saw God set up in Genesis was the institution of marriage. It was God himself who said, it is not good for man to be alone. After he looked at everything that he created and pat himself on the shoulder and said, this is good, that is good, that is good. The only thing he said is not good, is not complete, is man being alone. And he said, I'm going to fix him. I'm going to sort him out. So if somebody is wondering, does God care about the fact that I am single? Oh yes, he does. And it is his business to sort you out. Because one of the reasons why people could easily get into depression and gloominess and sadness and sorrow, and the devil would, you know, exploit their feelings and their emotions, is people saying, does God even care about where I am? Does God even care about my emotion? Of course he does. He looked at Adam and said, it is not good for this guy to be alone. The guy was busy running after monkey and chimpanzee and goats. It was God who pointed out that this guy is not complete. Let's help him. He has a situation and we're going to fix it. And you see, one of the first things I want to say to you this morning about your relationship and your marriage, whatever condition you are in, is relax. Let me tell your neighbor, say relax. You know, when I say relax, I mean relax, because some of the time you are too much bothered and your bothering is bothering God. You're so bothered that your bother is bothering God. And God is like, when will you chill? Do Netflix. Just chill. God is on your case. Let me tell your neighbor, say God is on your case. You know what God did to get Adam a wife? He put him to sleep. God is not trying to now put you to sleep. God is saying, can you trust me and just sleep by yourself? He had to put Adam to sleep because Adam was too active, running around. And God is like, if you remain this active, we won't be able to get you a wife. This is not my message, but this is the message of the Holy Spirit. He said, chill. Go and subscribe to Netflix and put on the internet and just watch TV and relax and say to the devil, can you get the hell out of here? I know that God is on my case. He's sorting me out. Don't go and look at things that will get you agitated. You see Instagram picture and somebody is hugging his wife. You're like, God, where? You know that question? God, where? Just say, Father, thank you. Because if you've done it for my neighbor, you're going to do it for me. Somebody says, when God blesses your neighbor, it is because God is in the neighborhood. If he's fixing others, it is a pointer to the fact that he's about to get to you. And he's going to sort you out. Can you just chill? He put Adam to sleep. Say, guy, relax. Your wahala is too much. Your trouble is too much. You just relax. And you see, one of the greatest stress you can put yourself is to think that you can sort out a good marriage outside of God. The very concept of marriage is not a straight line, it's a triangle. And God is on the top of the triangle. The man and the woman are at the base of the triangle. God is at the top of it. So if your marriage is going to be heaven and earth, if your marriage is going to be fantastic, you must understand the source of marriage. It wasn't Adam who brought the idea of marriage. Because many of you, when you go to God to pray about your marriage, the way you pray is like, God, I know you don't understand what I'm going through. God says, keep quiet. I was the one who understood the condition of the first Adam and brought the solution of relationship. So don't tell me, God, I know you don't know what I'm going through. What are you talking about? There is nothing you're going through that God doesn't know. He goes through it with you. Bible says, for we have not an high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He feels it all. The times you hold the pillow tight, God is there. He was the one that put that thing inside you. That feeling, that mushiness that you are feeling, it is part of the plans of God for you. So God sent me to you this morning to tell you, I know what you're going through. And if you can just relax, I'm going to sort you. Honestly, I'm going to sort you. Don't allow the devil to get your blood pressure your eye, and you are thinking, if your thinking could sort it out, you will have sorted it out before now. That's one major lesson that I learned early in life. That you see, worry will do much more damage to you in life. I was in the NYC camp a few years back, and so we were asked to submit our mattress. They gave us mattresses in the camp, right? And we were asked to submit it back on the day we were going to leave the camp. And then they gave us a slip, you know, that you needed that slip to be able to submit the mattress. And then they really said, make sure you don't lose the slip. I'm not a careless person, but somehow the slip went on the work of his own. And then I was not the only one in that situation. There was this other guy in my room, and I was the room captain, whose sleep also got missing. And this guy, after doing due diligence, searching for it like I did, he couldn't find it. While I was calm, he was so agitated. He was running, moving around like somebody that died that didn't want to die. You know what they call those people in Nigeria? You know, when somebody does not want to die and he now dies, you know, what people believe that somewhere in the spirit he's walking around. So when there is noise around, they say it's that dead person that is making noise. This guy was walking around the room and the hostel, just, you know, rambling and talking. And I'm like, guy, chill. It's their mattress. It's not even your daddy's mattress. It's government mattress. They will collect it from you. In any case, if your rambling and agitations could get the sleep to walk back. You know, sometimes I'm looking for something, I'm like, this thing, you are so stupid. You are somewhere and you cannot tell me where you are. Have you been in that place before? I'm like, my wife, this thing is very stupid. This thing that we are looking for, he's somewhere. Instead of the guy to say, sir, I am here, you will not talk. Stupid guy. So I don't bother myself. I do my due diligence to find it. So this guy, he was almost weeping. I'm like, what's your problem? This thing, so me, I packed the mattress. When everybody lined up, I lined up as if I had the sleep. And when I got to the guy that was taking the mattress, I said, I'm sorry, sir. On a normal day, I'm not a careless person, but this time, I honestly didn't know what happened. I have searched for it everywhere I could. I can't find it. And the guy said, not a problem. I'm like, not a problem. My goodness. So I just submitted it. I didn't. I blood pressure. I didn't complain and murmur all around town. When I was living the line, this our brother was he was still murmuring on around, moving about like a demon. You know, the devil says he's been doing to and fro upon the earth. That was what this guy was doing. So I went to him again. I said, brother, chill. God will sort you out. Go and stay on the line. Package the mattress. When you get there, tell them what happened. That you have bothered yourself so much, they will have mercy on you. They will have, and that's what God said I should say to somebody this morning. I will have mercy on you. Stop murmuring. Your murmuring can't solve the problem. That's chill. So let's go into the message proper. Matthew chapter 13. I want to talk about the farmer, the soil, and the seed. We started from there last month. The farmer, the soil, and the seed. In Matthew chapter 13, the Bible says, Jesus began to speak to the multitude that were by the seaside, and he spoke from verse 3 about what is popularly called the parable of the sower. He said, and he spoke many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, the sower went forth to sow. When he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them, but others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit. Some 100-fold, some 60-fold, and some 30-fold. I just do a quick recap. So we said that the relationship in marriage, the accurate marriage, is a triangle. There is God, who is the farmer. There is one of the spouses, who is the soil, the husband. There is the woman, who is the seed. So you see, what God does is a transplanting in a grief. He takes the woman out of her family and plants her upon a new soil. And then we said that in this parable, the revelation that God gave me from there is that you first need a relationship with the farmer, either as a seed or as a soil. Because the problem with us is that we are so eager to be planted that we jump out of the relationship with the farmer and we want to relate with the soil. The soil needs a relationship with the farmer. The seed needs a relationship with the farmer. For you to be a good seed, you must stay where the farmer kept you. There is some sort of preparation that goes on before a planting season. Am I talking to somebody this morning? You don't just look at any soil and say, I'm going to plant here. No. There is what is called soil preparation. So if you're going to be the accurate husband and the accurate wife, first and foremost, your relationship with God is critical. A man that is not changed cannot be a good husband material. You know how we measure husband material? 100 yards, 50 yards, 20 yards. There are materials that are no yards at all. As in like no yards. And if you make the mistake of putting your life into such materials, 0 times 100 is equal to 0. Is that correct?
Yes.
Because many times there are certain stresses that you could save yourself from fundamentally by just making the fine choice. Staying in the place of relating with the farmer so that you can fall upon the good ground. So we spoke about how that certain seeds, you know, can jump out of the hand of the farmer and go and fall by the wayside. God is taking them on a journey of personal transformation so that they can become good seed. He's also taking them, the soil on the other side, on a journey of personal transformation so that it can become a fertile soil. So you are looking at the high-yielding seed and a fertile soil. That's what makes a good marriage. High-yielding seed and a fertile soil. If you take a barren soil and an infested seed, what you are going to have is a bad marriage. Is somebody hearing what I'm talking about? There is no magic about it. So God is saying, don't be in a hurry. Let me work on you. When I work on you to a point, I can then tell you it's time to be planted. God can actually say, now it's time. Arise and go and get married. If you work sufficiently with him, he gets you to that place. Your work with God is not an accident. Your life in God is not an accident. Everything is planned. God is just saying, submit to my plan. That's why Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 3 that you do not lean on your own understanding. Don't walk by, oh, everybody is doing it, I will also do it. It may not necessarily be your season. And if you do it out of season, you will suffer it. So he said, lean not on your own understanding. Trust in me. So a good seed and a good soil. So we now add this seed who followed the farmer up to the point where he was planted upon a good soil. You saw, go and read again, you saw all what happened to the first three seeds that fell by the wrong soil. Some fell among thorns. There are guys that if you fall into their hands, even if you are a good seed, they will show you pepper. They are like thorny soils. Thorn as in like thorny. I was just relaxing last night and I saw a movie and it was a relationship movie and this guy, even if the wife picks phone call by his side, is problem. They were doing Mother's Day. The friend of the wife called the wife and then said, happy Mother's Day. And this girl said, same to you. That same to you was what brought you. Same to you, right? Same to you. You couldn't say it, feeling. Kuku say, I love you too. And I'm like, what's your stress? That's a bad soil. It's a terrible soil. A soil that does not trust. It's a terrible soil. If you are planted in such a soil, you know, like my father-in-law would say, he said, there are two things that can happen to you in marriage. You can either marry a prayer partner or you marry a prayer point. If you marry a prayer point, my brother, your prayer ministry will be very developed. I mean, the time you're supposed to use to relate with the father, what you will be doing is bringing petition to the father. Say, Father, I have come again. That man that I tell you, and God will be like, you see yourself? The time you should have spent with me in the place of relationship, intimacy, so that I can put you in the good soil. You dropped out of education. You know, there is nothing wrong with pregnancy in itself. It's getting pregnant out of season that is a problem. Are you understanding? There is nothing wrong with wanting to go after a boy or a boy coming after you. It's not seasons of life. So there is a point where your parents are saying, don't go after girls. And you don't go after boys. There is a season in your life where they are now saying, where are the boys? Where are the, and you're like, but you said, they said, you better don't try that. The season has changed. This is the right season to go after girls. It's about seasons. So God is saying, can you stay with me? Let's build intimacy. Let me teach you. There is a way that God teaches you, and when you see a woman, you can scan and say, this one. You know the Bible says they brought all the animals before Adam, and he named them. That process was a process of looking for a wife. So when Adam saw a monkey was standing on his 2 feet and had 2 hands and was looking kinky. But Adam said, no, this one is not the bone of my bone. He's monkey. He shall be called monkey. It's out of intimacy with God that you can see a person and say, even though he has mustache and he has 6 packs and he's looking good, TBH, tall, dark, and handsome, and he has a good job, but this one, he shall be called boxer. He's not husband. He shall be called boxers. And then you see another one and you say, this one, it shall be called husband. Husband material. Yes. And sometimes people cannot understand how that you can desire is out of intimacy with God. There is something that is called the knowing of revelation. That you will look at somebody and you say, I just know that this guy is my God. My kind of person. The Bible says, deep calleth to the deep. Yes, it is out of the depth of God that you carry that you can look at somebody and say, I think, let's start friendship. Yeah. And you will not be wrong. Adam woke up from that sleep and they brought a woman to him. Ah, the guy did naming ceremony. He started singing poetry. The guy started rapping. Come on, say, yo, this is the bone of my bone and the flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman. And God is like, God, you are deep. It's out of the depth of knowing God that you could know the woman. You didn't make a mistake. In me, it's a knowing of revelation. And you know, I was teaching on intimacy yesterday that every believer needs to go back to the place of intimacy and knowing God for ourselves. Because many people will go and submit this thing to a prophet, and the prophet will say, between these 3 names, this one, there is no future there, so they eliminate. He said, you see, this one, there is future there, but there is battle. There is no future there that does not have battle. Forget it. Leave matter. You don't use prophecy to design character. Prophecy doesn't give character. Because character has been given to you. After you need sense. Sense to know. Relational sense to know that this one doesn't have character. It's out of intimacy with God that you will know this is the bone of my bone and the flesh of my flesh. If you carry a bone that is not your bone, you are shimari. That's what it's called. It's going to hook you. It will hook that person in the neck. Just chill with God so that you can catch. So we had this seed that was good quality seed, and then it fell upon a good soil, which is very important. And then, you know, when Paul was talking to us about the life and the relationship of a man and a woman, he narrowed everything down to something. He just narrowed it down. It was a quick summary that he did in Ephesians chapter 5. And Paul just said, husbands, love your wives. Wives, respect. Because some people don't like to hear the word submit. So I will use New Living Translation. Wives, respect your husbands. So that's it. Summary, very sharp guy. He just summarized the whole thing. What we're going to be doing in the days, weeks, and months ahead is to break down what that love and respect means. Because if I just come to church, you know, like Old Testament pastors used to teach, they will just come and say, wives, submit. What is submission? If you don't teach us, we will never get it. You can easily look up to a man and say, man, love your wife. He doesn't understand what that word means until he understands it. Love is not something that can be defined. It's one of those things that you can describe. You have to describe it to the man for him to know. Oh, so this is what it means. Because you will hear guys say, I love him, but I love her, but things are not working. You don't love her. Because love is demonstrated. We need to look at the alphabet of love. They are coded. So the word love is just an all-encompassing word. The word submit or respect is an all-encompassing word. There is a way to unbundle it and break it down so that you understand what respect means to a man. You understand what love means to a woman. So I'm still going on my Greek lecture, you know. The soil must open up for a seed to come in. If there is going to be fruit, fruitfulness and productivity from the union of a seed and a soil, the soil must open up. And do you know that the process of opening up is painful? Soils are naturally made of hard texture. They are firm, right? So when a farmer wants to plant, he needs to cultivate the soil. You will need either hoe or cutlass, you know, or some mechanized farm implement to open up the soil. One of the reasons why marriages don't work is because men want a seed to be planted in them, but they don't open up for that seed to be planted. I'm going to help you break it down. So a man is 30 years, he's already made up the way he does his things, you know, his likes and dislikes, but now he wants to take a wife, which is a seed, right? And we are now talking about, in fact, even when it is a good seed, that is not enough to be a good seed and a good soil. There are things that must be done for that union of the seed and the soil to produce fruit. Because where God is taking us to is called marital fruitfulness. Is, you know, that they live together happily ever after that you read in a book. It's a possibility. No, it's a possibility. My father and the Lord has been married for 23 years. His own parents have been married for about 50 years or thereabouts. You have these things work. It works. But there are principles. So that soil is hard. The guy is a hard-hearted guy. He's already set in his ways. It's like, you know, he has his house already arranged before you came. This is how it is. And the first day he invites you to his house, you're like, this place is a mess. So look at his cutting. Look. That's because as soon as you begin to relate with a man, because you are a seed, you are looking for opening where you can fit him and then make certain adjustments. For fruitfulness to come out of that relationship, that man must open up and allow the seed to fit in before we can begin to talk about any fruit coming out of that union. The fruit of peace, the fruit of bliss. I'm not just talking about children. So the man must come to a point where he's allowing God to walk upon him. You know, in Genesis it says, for this reason shall a man leave his father and his mother and cleave. That process is a painful process. Cleaving is not easy. Because you are standing like this before the woman came. The woman is a part of you that was taken out, and then in marriage, she is now trying to come back. It's simple and Greek, right? The seed that we're about to plant was actually taken from a fruit that already germinated from the soil. Does it make any sense to you? So we are trying to take a seed that came out of the soil, we are trying to put it back in the soil. The rib that was taken out of the man, the place was already closed up. There is no surgical operation that does not have pain. They can only give you painkillers. So when God is saying you're going to get married, what he's trying to do for you as a man is that a rib that was taken out of you, that rib is now trying to incorporate itself back into the place where it was initially taken from. So you will need to open up. God will need to work on you. And you will need to, you cannot operate on a man that is not still. Am I talking to you this morning? You cannot operate. That's there will be accident. You will cut his nerves. You will cut his blood vessels. He will die. So he needs to come to a place and submit to the farmer and say, Lord, I am still. So the day the woman, my first week of marriage, as soon as we got back home, one of the first things I saw is that, can I talk? Praise God. So one of the first things you will see is that, so normally it's not a stress for me. I can scoop my stew from the pot and put my spoon in the pot. Is there anything wrong with that, Sister Rose? It's my pot, it's my spoon, it's my soup. I take my soup from the pot, I put the spoon back in the pot, and I cover it. It's simple and no stress at all. And then Mrs. Adebisi will come and say, no, no, no. Don't leave the spoon in the pot. I'm like, what does that matter? How does that change the soup? It's my soup, my pot, my spoon. I can leave it where. But he says, no. If you are hard, your relationship can break because of pot. Am I talking to you? Yes. The things that brings about argument and conflict in marriage, they are not special forces from the pit of hell. They are normal police officers, not SWAT, not SAS, because we are looking at NSAS. It's natural police that is the problem. Simple issues. Toothpaste. Somebody press it from behind. Somebody press it anywhere. What's your stress? Is it not toothpaste? The goal of the toothpaste is to wash your teeth. So if you cannot manage the fact that somebody is pressing it anyhow, go and buy your own and put it in your pocket. You cannot be hard-hearted. That's my point. So in Jeremiah, for instance, Jeremiah chapter 4, I want you to see that scripture. Jeremiah chapter 4, I'm just teaching marriage from a Greek this morning. Jeremiah chapter 4, he talks about the fact that you need to break up your fallow ground. A lot of men are breaking their own marriages because they want to have a seed planted in them, but they are not willing to open up. And God is saying, that's not how we do a Greek. Proper a Greek, you must open up. You will allow the farmer to use cutlass to dig out some soil. There are certain things that are in you that for as long as they are in you, your marriage will not work. That seed will not be able to come inside you. So God says, let me dig those things out so that we have a space to incorporate the seed, and then the seed can grow. Jeremiah chapter 4. It says, circumcise yourselves to the Lord. Let's read from verse 3. For thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah, listen, and men of Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. Because you can have a good seed that can be frustrated by a bad soil. The woman is good. What the average person calls for Allah will be poor is a normal thing for a woman. If you change that one and you marry another one, you will see the same thing. God is just saying, can you break up your fallow ground? That's your hard-heartedness. You are stiff in your ways. If you're going to walk with God, you cannot be stiff. You have to be fluid. You have to be fluid, malleable, changeable. For transformation to come into you, you must change state. You change state. So he says, break up your fallow ground, ye men of Judah and Jerusalem, and sow not among tongues. Look at verse 4. Because this change comes from the heart. He says, circumcise yourselves to the Lord and take away the foreskins of your heart, ye men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Until your heart is transformed, your life cannot change, your marriage cannot work. There must be a transformation of the mind. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. If God will change you, you must submit to him. Yeah. That's for the men. Let me quickly touch the women before we go. So you see, if a seed is going to prosper in the soil, he also has a part to play. You know, Jesus said in John, I think chapter 12, he said, except a corn of wheat fall to the ground. That's where a lot of people stop. They fall into marriage, but they are not willing to die. See, falling upon a man and say, oh, you are not happy, you did all the dance on the day of the marriage. That's not marriage. That one is the celebration. The real marriage starts the next day. Some people start their fight from honeymoon. Honeymoon. That's when they start the fight. The guy is like, let's start. The lady is like, I want to freshen up. The guy is like, I'm not complaining. Let's. The lady said, I want to freshen up. And that's why the fight started. Lack of understanding. So the Bible says that, you see, for any seed to grow, you can't just afford to fall on the ground. Falling on the ground does not bring growth. You have to die. That's the concept of submission. The woman must die. Your flesh, when I'm saying die, I don't say go and commit suicide. It's not dying by knife. He is dying to the flesh so that your spirit man can be alive. There are things that will happen in your marriage that if you react out of your flesh, that's the day your marriage will break. So Jesus is saying, if a corn of wheat will grow and bring forth fruit, it must first die, fall to the ground and die. And you know what the Lord said to me is that many people are falling to the ground, but they are not dying. And you are like, but I'm trying, I am falling to the ground. God says, don't just fall to the ground, die. It's a process. It's a journey. The soil and the seed are on a journey. The soil must open up. The seed must die. There are things that happens before you come to marital bliss. Before you hear people share testimony of 30 years together, they went through a process. There must be a dying. The seed must die. John chapter 12 verse 24 is that scripture. Verily I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall to the ground, it abides alone. It must fall to the ground and die. so that you can bring forth much fruit. See, this thing is all about choice. If you are going to choose a ground that you can die on. You know, somebody explained it like this. He said that it's like you want to make your hair, right? And you have many choices, many options of hairdressers. But you make up your mind that this one is the best, so you choose. That's choice. You have chosen a man to marry. But you don't just say, I've chosen, and then my hair will be done. No. You want to submit your hair to that hairdresser. One of the things that made me laugh while I was looking at this is that, you know, there is no matter, no matter how anointed you are, you will put your head under your baba. That baba may not be as anointed as you are. And you know, babas can be very naughty. They will say, sir, put your hair like this. They will hold your head, bend it this way. Hairdresser will also take your hair. It doesn't matter that she's younger than you are. But you want to submit your head under the hairdresser if your head will be named.
Yes, sir.
So the seed must submit to the soil. And God is saying, I'm not going to kill you. You are going to have to die yourself. So it's a conscious journey, a deliberate journey. Many of us, you know what we are doing? We are falling on the ground, but we are struggling. And like, God, I don't want to die. Me and this guy, we will sort it out. We will give it. If he gives it to me, I will give it to him. God is saying, you will never bring forth fruit that way. It can be a painful process, but the joy is in the fruit. 9 months of pregnancy is not easy. It's a death process. It's a death process. You die to your appetites. The things that you used to eat normally, you can't eat it now. The things that you used to do, all the exercise, you can't do it. Your tummy is now big. But the day you hold your baby in your hands, you're like, oh my gosh, the journey is worth it after all. That's the same thing that happens in marriage. No good marriage happens by its own. There's an opening of the soil. There is a dying of the seed, which is a lifelong process if we're going to bring forth fruit. That's important. Those are the two things I'm going to drop with you today. Next month, if the Lord wills, we will now start looking about many other things that come with that process. I wasn't so good in Greek, but Greek is coming back to my mind.
Oh, yeah.
I'm seeing photosynthesis, so many things. All of these things can be explained with the scriptures. It's a process if you're going to give back to fruitfulness in your marital life. It's possible. You know, one of the lies the devil wants to sell to us is that marriage is a necessary evil, that you don't need it. Just, if God has given you the gift of celibacy and singleness, I'm not against it. But if that is not your gift, my brother, you will suffer. My sister, it's going to be very hard. Especially in this winter. It's going to be very hard. Don't allow the devil to punish you. Just allow God to work on you and you can enjoy it. Can we stand up to our feet this morning? I know that God has spoken to you within that short period. Can you pray to God this morning and say, Lord, help me to submit to your process? That's the word. Even for those of us that are already married, the process is continuous. The process is continuous. Can you pray and say, Lord, I submit to your process. I submit to your process. Help me, Jesus. Help me, Jesus, to yield myself to you. Either as a man or as a woman. Lord, we receive grace to yield. We receive grace to yield. We receive grace to yield so that we can bring forth fruit. 100-fold, 60-fold, 30-fold. Our life must not be barren. Our relational life cannot be barren. To make the right choice if you're single, Lord, I receive grace to walk with you, to know the things that I need to know, to be able to make the right choices. I receive grace this morning to submit to you, to submit to you in walking with you, Holy Spirit, to submit to you so that I can be a great husband, so that I can be a great wife. We receive grace, oh God. We receive grace. Let this word change us. Let this word transform us. Let it bring about change in our life. That our minds will become a pleasure, heaven on earth. That men will see us and say, yours is different. Others are saying there is a casting down, but you are saying there is a lifting up. We give you praise and glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we are.